environments of the sea and land are so starkly different that a transition from one to the other seems virtually impossible. Nevertheless, they are the dual stage of a grand drama which took place over the course of 4 billion years. Some creatures birthed in the sea climbed up onto the land, while others returned to the oceans from whence they came. This odyssey from sea to land, and then back to the sea, is an integral part of the history of life. It is thanks to the pioneering creatures that first set foot on land that human beings exist today. This is a desert located 150 kilometers southwest of Cairo, the capital of Egypt. It is a vast sea of sand which seems to be utterly bereft of life. Yet it is this barren land that harbors vestiges of the greatest mystery in the history of life. To paleontologists who trace the history of life, this is a treasure trove of information. Buried within the hot desert sand are ancient bones. 30 years ago, Philip Gingrich of the University of Michigan made a startling discovery here. He discovered the fossil of an ancient whale.
And this means it's an experiment in whale evolution that didn't happen before and was very successful, but didn't happen after. You can see it looks like recent bone. It looks like it died yesterday. But here it is in the sandstone for 37 million years. So that's why Wadi Hitan is important.
He unearthed over 1,000 fossils in this place called Wadi Hitan, or Valley of the Whales. 37 million years ago, these parched lands were covered by the Tethys Ocean. Before Professor Gingrich discovered this fossil, not much was known about the origins of the modern whale. Whales are a rare instance where a terrestrial animal returned to the sea, but until then, the exact reasons for this remained a mystery. The key to unraveling this mystery is Basilosaurus, the ancient forerunner of the modern whale. Seven million years ago, Basilosaurus ruled the Tethys Ocean. It was 16 meters long, with a gaping mouth and serrated teeth. And unlike most other aquatic creatures, it had a pair of hind legs. Today, vertebrates dominate the world, and the hind legs of the Basilosaurus are a characteristic that is unique to land-dwelling animals. Man is one of them. In order to find the link between Basilosaurus and land-dwelling animals, we must travel back eons to the origin of life itself. Earth in its infancy was an environment hostile to life. the atmosphere was over 80 degrees Celsius and devoid of any oxygen. But after millions of years, a miracle occurred. The first living organisms appeared on the Earth, birthed by the ocean. $3.5 billion years ago, the ocean was rich with oxygen, and the horizon glowed with a sapphire hue of the water. It was at this time that stromatolite, the first form of life, appeared. This primitive organism was in fact colonies of blue-green algae, which survived through photosynthesis and produced abundant amounts of oxygen. Thanks to this organism, Earth's atmosphere became oxygen-rich, creating an environment that was conducive to life. $500 million ago, the seas began to teem with an endless variety of strange-looking creatures. They possessed long tentacles and fearsome spines and were protected by stone-hard armor. This sudden proliferation of life is called the Cambrian explosion of life. Scientists believe that the ancestors of most of the animals in existence today appeared at this time. This creature swimming through the water using its wing-like appendages is Animalocaris. Over a meter long, this animal was the largest and most fearsome predator of the Cambrian oceans. It could pierce through the hard armor of a trilobite with a single bite. Competition for survival grew fierce, and creatures were forced to modify themselves to survive. During this time, a transformation occurred, altering the course of evolutionary history. It was the tiny pacaya, a creature no larger than a thumb, which was the constant target of larger predators.
When we look at pacaya, we are really stepping into the door of vertebrate evolution. We are there, as we say in English, on the ground floor. These are the opening moments of this extraordinary story, which is going to take another half a billion years.
The pacaya developed a stiff rod on its back called a notochord. It was the precursor of the spine.
But when we look closely, we actually see that there are quite a lot of details. We can see the front end, and we can see the tail. And then, most interesting, roughly along here, there is a distinctly different zone.
The notochord proved to be a revolutionary improvement. The notochord and the V-shaped muscles around it, called myomeres, worked in concert to propel this creature forward, giving it unprecedented speed and power. This is how pacaya probably looked as it swam. Its propulsion method is similar to that of modern fish. Despite being an apex predator, Animalocaris soon became extinct. But pacaya managed to survive. While it was armed with neither eyes nor a protective shell, it could elude even the fiercest of predators using its superior speed. Pacaya's legacy is significant in the history of evolution.
Once you've got a notochord, once you've got the myomeres, then you're on the way to becoming a fish. Once you're on the way to becoming a fish, you're on the way to becoming an invertebrate. And once you are on the way to becoming a vertebrate, then you're on the way to becoming us.
Had the pacaya become extinct, The history of life on Earth would have ended 500 million years ago in the sea. Instead, these tiny protovertebrates were slowly preparing to become fish. Years ago, the primitive notochords become fully developed vertebral columns. This is the fossilized ancestor of all vertebrates, including man.
And the black pieces you can see on the surface here are pieces of an arandaspid fish called Sacabambaspis. Now these are some of the very earliest fishes where the scales and armor was on the surface of the fishes.
While the fossil is incomplete, it shows the distinct traces of scales, a feature that is unique to fish. This is Arandaspis, the first fish. It was covered in scales like the countless fish species that came after it, but because it did not have fins, it was an awkward and painstakingly slow creature. Also, it was a jawless fish, which sucked water through an opening in its belly and subsisted on the various microorganisms which it was able to strain. After another 100 million years, a new fish appeared. This is a fishing village in Indonesia. Here, fishermen caught a strange fish which they had never before seen in their lives. The fish that had become tangled in their nets was none other than a living fossil.
Lantas ikan itu dikeluarkan dari perahu, dibawa ke darat. Di sebelahnya ada sumur. Malah di situ hampir dipotong ikan itu. Tetapi ada satu warga masyarakat, Bapak Darwin, ternyata dia pernah melihat ikan ini di Fakultas Teknik di Mapala. Ada posternya besar.
So what does this fish look like? They open the lid and clear the ice away to reveal the coelacanth. Scientists believe the species had gone extinct during the Cretaceous period when dinosaurs roamed the Earth. It takes the strength of three men to lift the fish onto a table. These animals can grow up to 2 meters long and reach 90 kilograms in weight. Like most other ancient fish species, they are armed with sharp teeth and thick scales. Also, they carry their eggs with them and give birth to fully developed young. But the feature that makes this fish truly unique is its fins. The fish is equipped with large, powerful fins. This foreshadowed an important new evolutionary development. This is Miguasha National Park, located in Quebec, Canada. The sedimentary layers here are up to 380 million years old. Hundreds of millions of years ago, this used to be close to the tropical equator. At the time, a river flowed through this area, and it was populated by a diverse array of fauna that comprised a complicated food chain. It is here, in the geological strata of the cliff, that traces of a significant evolutionary leap can be found. On exhibit in the museum is a fossil of a fish that is strikingly similar to the coelacanth. The species first appeared in the Devonian period. It was a large fish that breathed through its lungs and possessed a set of powerful fins. Called Eustonopteron, its name literally means powerful fins. The fins of the fish have a feature that had not been found in previous species. The fins contain bones.
We have one major element that is articulating with the shoulder girdle, and this element is the humerus, exactly the same element that we're finding in our arm or in the arms of the earliest tetrapods.
The bone fins of Eustonopteron are proof that the limbs of terrestrial animals originated in fish. But why did this fish develop bones in its fins?
These most likely will be used to move in a very swampy environment, just to move among the plants. So that is giving not just a very thin fin, but that will give a very strong paddle that the animal will be able to push the plants to get into environment to find its food.
Eustonopteron was a skilled swimmer. It used its powerful fins to propel itself freely through the water. Also, it was an excellent hunter with well-developed jaws and teeth. But the Devonian seas were the stage for a fierce battle for survival. And Dunkleosteus ruled supreme. At 6 meters in length, Dunkleosteus was a true behemoth. It was a placoderm which possessed powerful jaws and a thick plate of armor. Equipped with razor-sharp teeth, it often preyed on Eustonopteron. In order to avoid this vicious predator, Eustonopteron undertook a risky journey. It left the ocean in search of a new habitat. It used its powerful fins in order to swim into a river, and then to other bodies of fresh water.
In the water, there are huge fish, some of them about 16 feet long, of all different kinds, armored fish, all kinds of predatory fish. It was a remarkable period.
During the Devonian period 370 million years ago, the land was a place full of opportunity. Trees appeared, foresting the barren terrain, and rivers began to flow. The fish which populated these rivers heralded a new era in evolutionary history. Paleontologist Neil Shubin discovered a fossil which would shock the scientific world and be called the missing link. He discovered this unknown species on Ellesmere Island in northern Canada. It was named Tiktaalik, or large freshwater fish, in Inuktitut, the language of the local Native American tribe. Although it had a flat lizard-like head, its scales showed that it was clearly a fish.
And for the first time, we're seeing the kinds of fish that can actually leave the water, that can make the transition from life in water to life on land. So all kinds of new things are happening.
Tiktaalik harbors clues to the gradual evolution of land-dwelling animals from the sea. Unlike most other fish, the Tiktaalik had a flat head with eyes on the top of its skull. Another distinctive feature is this. Tiktaalik possessed a neck. This was a new feature that wasn't present in previous fish. Tiktaalik uses this neck to rotate its head freely and scour its surroundings. But the real reason the Tiktaalik is called the missing link is its fins. Its fins are more powerful and intricately designed than that of Eustenopteron. Tiktaalik had shoulders, elbows, and even wrists.
Now, what's very special about this is not only that these are bones that compare to our own arms, but if you look at the surfaces of this, there's surfaces for all kinds of muscles. And not just any kinds of muscles, muscles that would have helped the animal do a kind of push-up to support itself against the ground.
Tiktaalik was a revolutionary fish. It could move its neck freely and scour its surroundings with its eyes located on top of its skull. Its fins were equipped with elbows and wrists and were strong enough to support its gigantic body. The appearance of this fish signaled a new movement towards the land. Thus began the long and arduous process of adjusting to the new terrestrial environment. So, how did Tiktaalik use its versatile fins? Mudskippers, which live in the tidelands of Korea, give us an idea of how Tiktaalik must have moved. The mudskipper uses its pectoral fins to support itself while crawling around on its belly. Tiktaalik must have climbed onto the land using its fins in much the same manner.
Water was loaded with competitors, large fish, small fish, everything competing for food. Some of those fish would eat you. If you look at land, there are plants there. There's food there in that these early insect-like creatures. So there are advantages for creatures leaving the water to go to land to remove themselves from the competition for food resources, but also to escape some of the predation that was going on in the water as well.
After Tiktaalik, the evolution of the fish became even more accelerated. Paleontologist Jennifer Clack shows us a sketch of a small lizard-like creature. This is Acanthostega, a species which marked another turning point in the history of evolution. Acanthostega is a freshwater fish which lived 360 million years ago during the Devonian period. It had four almost fully formed legs and breathed air using its lungs. Also, it had something very unique, which Tiktaalik did not have.
One of the first things that we found was that on each limb, there were eight fingers or toes, which was a big surprise.
It was the first creature in the history of evolution to have fingers and toes.
Previously, people had thought that the primitive number for fingers and toes was 5, because that's what we have. But it turns out that when tetrapods with limbs first evolved, they had more than 5. Acanthostega has had 8, but we also have other animals from the same time with 7 or 6.
This is a shallow lake in the late Devonian period. Acanthostega uses its webbed feet to dart through the water, weaving through various obstacles along the way. It hides among aquatic plants and snatches a passing fish. Acanthostega, which possessed both lungs and gills, finally took the first steps onto land. The adjustment to land did not happen overnight. The appearance of the first spine, fin equipped with muscle and bone, and the first legs and toes was the result of billions of years of trial and error. Millions of years passed by after the appearance of Acanthostega, and the competition for survival in the water grew increasingly fierce. But it was a different story altogether on land. The terrestrial ecology was still full of opportunities. Then, 280 million years ago, the first complete tetrapod appeared on land. Descended from Acanthostega, it could only breathe air through its lungs, and it didn't have to return to the water in order to spawn. The adaptation to land was complete. It was a moment of monumental significance on par with man's landing on the moon.
The transition from life in water to life on land is one of the great events in the history of life. And it's an event that changed the world forever. For the first time, we have creatures walking on land, feeding on land. But it's not just an event that's captured in the past. It's actually an event that's inside our own bodies, because many of the features that occurred for the first time in the fish that walk on land are part of us.
The fish that climbed onto land were the weakest members of the food chain. They left behind the competitive underwater environment in order to survive, but through change and adaptation, they achieved the Herculean feat of adapting to a completely new and alien environment. Once tetrapods had reached the land, they began to proliferate quickly. They diverged into millions of species, including amphibians, reptiles, birds, and even mammals. Among their ancestors, mammals reared and breastfed their young and became the masters of the earth. Once the weakest creatures of the sea, they achieved a brilliant success through their mastery of the land. But there is a mystery in the history of life that still remains unsolved. It is the existence of mammals in the ocean. This is a marine mammal called the dugong. It uses its fins like arms and feeds on aquatic plants. It breathes air through its lungs, so it must surface regularly. It also births its young and breastfeeds them. So why does the dugong possess characteristics that are common to land-dwelling mammals? The dugong swims away without revealing any of its secrets. We return to the Egyptian desert in order to unravel this mystery. Called Wadi Hattan, or Valley of the Whales, this desert has been designated as a World Heritage by UNESCO. There is a line of vertebrae in the sand. Although this fossil was called the Lizard King when it was first discovered, that was later on proven to be a misnomer. Basilosaurus was far from a lizard.
Basilosaurus represents an early stage of whale evolution. It's one of the first aquatic whales, fully aquatic whales.
Once the dominant species of the Tethys Ocean, this primitive whale lived from 42 million to 34 million years ago. The largest whale at the time, this creature swam by weaving its long body through the water. It had a pair of underdeveloped hind legs, which seemed puny in comparison to its gargantuan size. This is the clue which will help us unravel this mystery. This is a Basilosaurus fossil unearthed in Wadi Hattan. This animal was also called the walking whale, because of its hind legs. Although they were small, the legs were fully formed appendages. They are proof that ancestors of Basilosaurus once roamed the land.
The general trend, life started in the sea, and this means that the general trend, from our point of view at least, is to come out onto the land. And the whale has gone back, and so in that sense is a reversal. It's backwards.
There is another mammal that returned to the ocean. It's Dorudon, a smaller primitive whale that was around 5 meters long. The raging desert winds revealed whales that had been buried for countless millennia. Professor Philip Gingrich has recently discovered a new fossil embedded in a cliff in Wadi Hattan. It's a fossil of Dorudon.
This is the first time that we know how complete is Dorudon, how many backbones, how long it is. It's the first time we know that these whales have legs and feet and toes, and it's because of the excellent preservation.
This whale with large jaws, serrated teeth, and tiny hind legs is directly linked to land-dwelling mammals. It was a skilled swimmer that lived in the oceans 37 million years ago. But its method of swimming was completely unlike that of any fish. This is another clue which hints at the origins of the whale. The mechanics of Dorudon are reminiscent of the manner in which land mammals use their spines in order to run. What is going on? 65 million years ago, at the end of the Cretaceous period, a giant asteroid collided with the Earth, killing off the dinosaurs which had reigned supreme for many eons. This was the incident which spurred the whale to return to the sea.
After the Cretaceous Paleogene extinction event and dinosaurs are gone, the marine reptiles are gone, then there is no top predator in the sea. And so I see it more as opportunity, not something pushing from behind, but something pulling from in front.
So which species was it exactly that returned to the sea? This fossil of Pachycetus is the key to unraveling this mystery. This creature had four powerful legs and seems to have nothing in common with a whale. Also, its vertebrae were still attached to each other, making its spine suitable for terrestrial living. Yet it had a specialized ear bone inside its skull. Only whales possess this bone, which is used to detect sounds underwater. This is a sea near modern-day Pakistan 50 million years ago. Pachycetus was an amphibious, wolf-like creature. It took to the seas because they were abundant with food and less populated than land. It also possessed long webbed toes, which allowed it to swim freely in the water. And it possessed a specialized ear bone, which allowed it to hear the sounds of its underwater prey. The animal used this hearing to catch fish with its long snout and razor-sharp teeth.
To hear in water is completely different than to hear in air. And so the hearing apparatus has to be modified. You can
see it's about this ancestor of the whale transformed its body to adapt to its new underwater lifestyle. Although it could only detect underwater sounds at first, later developments allowed it to locate the direction from which the sounds came. The bullet is very small. This creature changed everything in order to adapt to the water. Its forelegs became its pectoral fins, and its superfluous hind legs devolved. Also, its tail became wide and flat in order to propel it through the water. Lastly, its nostrils moved toward the top of its skull to facilitate underwater breathing. In this way, the ancestor of the whale adapted completely to the ocean. Pachycetus, which had maintained an amphibious lifestyle for countless millennia, finally left the land for good. It had completed its transformation and become primitive whales such as Dorudon and Basilosaurus. This return to the ocean is one of the most amazing incidents to occur in the history of life on the Earth.
The fish coming out on land very early in vertebrate history, and the whale going back to the sea late in vertebrate history, have this similarity. I think both are taking advantage of some opportunity. It's a nice comparison because it shows that evolution is not determined and directional. Instead, it's opportunistic, and if the opportunity is behind, we will go back.
But this is not the end of the story. 34 million years ago, around the end of the Eocene epoch, the Tethys Ocean, which was heavily populated by primitive whales, began to dry up, and the temperature of the Earth plummeted. It was at this time that Basilosaurus, the largest whale species of the era, and its lesser cousin Dorudon, met with different fates. It was the smaller species Dordon that managed to survive in the frigid waters where food had become scarce. And it became the forefather of the modern whale. On the other hand, the large and inefficient Basilosaurus could not avoid extinction. In this way, these rare primitive whales have become buried in the sands of time. Nevertheless, these prehistoric behemoths leave us with an unmistakable message.
Some people are interested in the stars and outer space and how far we can see. I'm interested in time and how far back we can see, because all our understanding and expectation for the future is conditioned on what we understand about the present and the past. The study of deep time, the study of life through time, understanding where we came from, how we are part of the earth, how we are part of the history of the earth.
To some, fossils are merely the petrified remains of creatures from ages past. But it is these creatures that risk their lives to forge a pathway into the unknown terrestrial environment. And their legacy has withstood the test of time, not only surviving in the new environment, but thriving in it. We are their legacy.
Thank you.